Financial contracts are not easy on the eyes, but they can be very heavy on the wallet if you have no clue how to decode them. So today, we'll talk about making sense of legalese. I'm Edric Mendoza, and this is On The Money. Attorney Eirene Jhone Aguila practiced corporate law and litigation in one of the country's top law offices. She has agreed to help On The Money discuss practical tips on scrutinizing financial contracts. Hello, Attorney Eirene.
Hi, Edric.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Love the pre-talks we had earlier.
Yeah, so did I. I missed you.
Yeah, I know. It's amazing how, you know, we ended up here and we're going to be talking about contracts from our college days. Anyway, so let's start and help our viewers. The first question I think I have is, what would you say are the most common ways consumers can get hurt or things that they will overlook when it comes to financial contracts?
Okay, I think the things that can actually affect a consumer if they don't really peruse their contracts or read their contracts well is that they eventually end up paying more than they thought they would shell out for a particular service or good. Either that, or they don't know how to run after the seller or the service provider if things don't go their way. And another thing is that they don't really get their money's worth. Like, there are other benefits you can actually derive from your contracts or some other promises your seller actually agreed to from the get-go, yet if you don't read the fine print,
you won't know that you're missing out
on these things.
Okay. Yeah. So it's not just for protection, but it's actually for extra bonuses like that. Pwede pala yan. Okay. So why do you think Pinoys in general, because you were saying earlier that Pinoys in general don't?
Yes, I think.
Why?
Well, one, I think we don't really like reading, you know, voluminous things.
Unless you're a lawyer, like yourself.
Unless, perhaps. Or unless it's the, you know, some juicy story, you know, or some rumor here and there, right? But if it's a fine print, for one, it's not exactly nice to the eyes.
Mm,
you
know?
They're
so
really
much
written in microscopic font. They use really long words. And I think Pinoys in general don't feel that, sadly, I don't think they feel like they're at par with the sellers, you know, that they enjoy the same, that they're on equal footing.
Okay.
Right? You're dealing with these big companies. Let's say you're taking out a line from a cell phone company. You're like one out of a million subscribers. So you don't feel like you can actually, you actually have the right to ask what your rights are or what's due to you as a consumer. So that, I think that mindset is not very prevalent among consumers. And we don't even complain well, you know. If something goes wrong, you rant about it, you complain on Facebook, but you don't exactly go to customer service, ask for remedies, ask for things to be remedied.
Again, because of our culture.
Yes, I think it's very Pinoy, you know.
Nakakahiya,
or parang, you know, parang liit lang naman to. I'm just a small buyer, diba? So parang, why will they pay attention to me?
Right. But I think what you're saying, so step one is people obviously have to read.
Yes.
People have to take the time to just read the contracts. Can you give concrete examples of stories you might have come across or incidences where talagang the consumer was really, really at a loss because an oversight, not reading their contracts?
Yeah, actually, like I think that's very common, you know, from people buying all these, from airline tickets, for instance. Airline tickets for watchers, for viewers out there, they're actually contracts of carriage, you know, meaning when you buy an airline ticket, there's a fine print that you actually have to read.
On the ticket?
On the ticket. Yeah. It's at the back of your ticket. Or the when you print it out, it's at the bottom
the
of
e-ticket,
that, that really long listing. I mean, it lists there whether you can actually get a refund for late flights, if you're bumped off, you know. And there are people who book these tickets for weddings, and then they're bumped off, and then they just cry. You know, you don't, you miss
a
wedding.
What can you do?
What can you do?
You didn't read the fine print.
Yeah, or like you carry with you when you board, let's say a bus, something valuable. You don't declare it.
Right.
So when it gets lost, you demand that the
company,
that the transportation company pay you the amount.
But
in the ticket, it also says if you don't reveal the value, they're not going to pay you for that value. They're only going to pay you a standard amount. You know, so
even in everyday items like bus tickets,
In the everyday items that you have, cell phone deals, and
new
of course
lines,
the more
like
complicated ones like insurance policies.
So let's talk about the realm, if you will, of contracts. Which one would you say are the contracts that people should watch out for the most?
Well, I think, for instance, you have the I think a common contract would be contract of sale.
Okay.
right?
Property,
so yeah, property, if you're buying a home, buying a condo, mm-hmm. then you'd have to check there the obligations of the mm-hmm. seller mm-hmm. or the vendor mm-hmm. and your obligations or duties as the buyer. Mm-hmm. Then the other kinds of contracts would include insurance, you know, with the recent spate of typhoons, you have Ondoy and mm-hmm. Piping and all that. People are taking out different kinds of contracts for their vehicles, right?
Then acts of God, etc.
So you'd have to check whether these are covered by your mm-hmm. contracts or are they exclusions. Mm-hmm. You know, then you also have everybody going into the fitness thing. So you have your health insurance.
Right.
Then health for insurance. Everybody who's of working age, employment contracts, of course, is a necessity to look at and to study well. And as you're earning, you need to understand also your contracts with your banks. Right? What are the terms that are involved with or that are covered by these relationships that you have with your banking institutions?
Okay. So let's try and drill down each of the general categories you said and maybe give our viewers and myself principles of what terms to watch out for.
Yeah.
And maybe there are big terms that you can help explain that are commonly used, you know, that might be intimidating to a typical consumer. Why don't we start with loan contracts?
Okay,
like so for houses, you're pulling out a loan.
So for loan contracts, right, everybody would understand that if you take out a loan, you need to repay.
Okay.
And then there's a thing called interest, meaning it's the fee that you pay over the amount that you borrowed, right?
Correct.
But people forget that loaning out of money is also a business. So it complicates things when you have such thing as prepayment penalties.
Okay.
What does it mean? If you take out a loan, your goal is to pay me back if I loan you. But you forget that not sometimes when you pay back too soon, I lose out on the business of loaning it to you.
That's prepayment. Mm-hmm.
So you prepay, right? So what happens is I pass on a penalty which you will have to pay. So those are the terms that people actually gloss over. They forget that it's not so much that you pay back. You have to understand and do your math whether it's smart for you to prepay.
Right.
Otherwise, you're paying penalties when you could have used that money somewhere else, right? And for loans, you have to understand the concept of floating interest rates. Is it pegged at a particular interest?
Fixed?
Yes. Is it fixed? Is it going to be changing?
Mm-hmm.
And what are the conditions that will push it to change, that will surface the changes.
Right. So I guess it helps to ask what if questions, I mean,
yes,
in that case.
Yeah.
So what if I prepay? Mm-hmm. What if I don't pay on time? What if? That's ways to look through the legalese as well. What about, you talked about investment contracts or insurance contracts, things like that.
Yeah,
I mean,
what
should people watch out for?
For insurance contracts, one of the most contentious parts there would be the exclusions.
Right.
By exclusions, we mean the particular acts that will not be paid for by your insurance.
That are not covered.
Yes, that are not covered or paid for by your insurance company.
So watch out for those.
Yes, you have to watch out for those. Like, for instance, you take out the health insurance policy. Then one of the exclusions there is that you shouldn't do any activity that is a bit hazardous. So no contact sports in general. Then you decide to take up boxing.
Yeah.
Okay, then something happens.
Martial arts.
Yeah, you want them to pay out your insurance. And then some of them will say no because it's excluded. Right.
Good.
So you have to also be more conscientious in deciding how you want your life to go if you take out these things, right? Other companies, instead of having exclusions, they have what's called loading. They load, meaning they increase your premium depending on the exclusions you would like to sort of include later. For instance, the car insurance policies, before acts of God were not covered.
Right, until recent
until
events
Ondo
in
and
our
all
country,
these
yeah.
things. Yeah. So people started adding or asking if acts of God could be included, then they'd load up on the premium, meaning they increased the premium, so those are the things that people have to be aware of.
Okay. Employment contracts?
Of course, what to watch out for? I think most fundamental for employment contracts, which we take for granted, I think, in general, is whether or not there really exists an employer-employee relationship.
Fundamental, because
your contract will actually sort of give you a hint whether or not they're
actually just hiring you
on a commission basis.
Yeah.
As an agent versus somebody who's hired as
with
a
benefits,
project,
et cetera,
yes, a fixed term or a regular employee with benefits, and those will spell out what you can demand from your employer. But a lot of us, so long as we get a job, mm-hmm. you know, we're happy. We're happy, yeah.
You don't care about what exactly
you have to be, you have to know, because if you're caught in a bind, you won't know how to fight your case.
Okay, yeah. That makes sense. Earlier, we were talking to someone who had a problem not reading their contract, mm-hmm. if you remember that person. And there was a term that we talked about. It had to do with property, mm-hmm. a contract with properties. And there was a term you talked about, which is implied warranties.
Or, yeah, warranty against hidden defects, actually. Okay. Like, in general, if you buy anything, let's say you buy... you buy a car, for instance, you buy a condo, mm-hmm. then there's a, if you, let's say you're not an engineer, you're not an architect, right? You buy a condo, they tell you that this condo ideally should be livable, mm-hmm. right? Meaning the structure should be good.
Safe, etc.
Okay, so mm-hmm. you buy it, you look at it, there are no cracks on the walls, nothing mm-hmm. apparent, mm-hmm. nothing physically visible. Then you buy it. And then when you're staying, once you occupy, you realize or... that the structure isn't that good. Mm-hmm. That once you have an earthquake of a
it's not stable,
small
it's
magnitude,
not safe, yeah.
it's not. It's going to crumble.
Right.
So that the seller actually breached on its on his warranty against mm-hmm. hidden defects. Mm-hmm. But because of that, you actually have a choice. Now you have a choice of actually withdrawing from the contract or asking that the price be reduced. And in mm-hmm. both instances, you have the right to ask for damages. The case is different, though, if you were an architect mm-hmm. or an engineer yourself. Because of your specialized knowledge, then from the get-go, you'd have to be a bit more, you'd have to know how to scrutinize a bit more.
Right.
Yeah, but in general, I think we have to remember that the people who sell us things promise that these goods that we buy can actually be used with the,
for the
intention and for the purpose that we're buying it for.
Yes. Yeah.
If short of that, we can actually run after them
sure.
with damages.
Sure. I have more questions for you, and I'm sure there's a lot more we can discuss. But for now, we have to take a short break. So keep it here on The Money. We'll be right back. Welcome back to On The Money. Let's check what Salve Duplito has for us today. And Salve says...
Who signs contracts without reading them? Apparently, almost everybody. Reading fine print is not as painful as pulling tooth, but almost as irritating as oral prophylaxis. Nobody wakes up in the morning raring to put this task number one in his to-do list. While most of us can get away with this, remember that some financial contracts, unread and misunderstood, can haunt you. Pay close attention specifically to investment or insurance contracts and real property purchase contracts. Let's talk about investment and insurance contracts. Since the weakening of the pre-need industry, Filipinos have been buying variable universal life insurance, or what they call VULs. VULs are marketed as a combination of insurance and investment. Part of the money you pay is placed in mutual funds. But here's what you need to look for in the fine print. When exactly does the company begin investing your money in funds? Sales agents tend to gloss over the fact that for the first 2 or 3 years, most of your money will go to insurance premiums and their commissions rather than to investments. This means that you better not expect returns on your investments in a year or two. But they won't tell you that. You have to look for this in the fine print yourself. Second, know your rights when it comes to purchase contracts. For example, there's such a thing as, quote, warranties against hidden defects. Article 1562 of the Civil Code says that there is an implied warranty or condition as to the quality or fitness of goods sold. Simply put, that means a structure is supposed to stand, a car is supposed to run, and so on. My aunt who lives in Seattle, Washington, bought a condo unit in a building in the fort. No one lives in her unit, and yet it flooded when a substandard pipe burst because of water pressure. Water leaked down to units directly under her level. The developer said she was supposed to pay for all the damages. That could have run up to more than $1 million in expenses. What a horror story. After a certain amount of legal football, the developer finally agreed that it was their fault and shouldered all the expenses. So lessons learned from Salvices today. Read the fine print and know your rights. Unwillingness to read legalese is not an excuse for ignorance.
Still with us is attorney Eirene Jhone Aguila, who will answer some of the questions you sent to us via email, Twitter, and Facebook. And Melissa Hekule has those questions. Hi, Mel.
Hi, Edric. Hi, attorney Eirene. Anyway, the first question comes from Bren, and she asks, I just bought a condo 4 years ago, and it was turned over to me last month. It does not look at all like the model units that they showed me, and the plumbing is not that good. What can I do?
I think the first thing we have to remember in buying, you know, with all this buying frenzy when it comes to condos sprouting out everywhere, is to try to understand the disclaimers of these condo developers, right? They'll show you a model unit, but somewhere there, they'll tell you that there's a disclaimer saying that this might not exactly be the condo you're buying. So you have to be aware of something like that. I'm sure it's written down somewhere. So look for that. Yeah, in the small print. But with regard to the plumbing question, that was the thing I was referring to, Edric, earlier, that when a seller actually sells you something, he's promising that there are no hidden defects. Plumbing is not something you can verify immediately even, right? So because of that hidden defect, you can actually ask that the contract, you can actually ask to withdraw from the contract, perhaps ask for a reduction of the price, and in both instances, ask that damages be paid to you. Unless, of course, your contract provides that there's a
they're protected from any defect. That's
like
what you're talking about,
You know, they have a way of going around it. That's why you have to really read. But in general, that's a hidden defect which the consumer can assert.
Okay. What's some of the legal jargon that buyers should be looking out for?
Well, you should look out, for instance, for exclusions. Exclusions don't apply just to insurance companies, even for service contracts and for things like this, such that, for instance, you're buying a condo unit, and then they'll tell you, okay, this is good for its use, but if you put a restaurant here, we're not anymore assuring that it will function well. And then once you do and you didn't read it, and then you complain later, you really have no
protection.
You're protected.
So you have to watch out for those things. That's very important. And you have to watch out for the possible grounds for breach, because you as a buyer, you have an obligation to the seller, meaning to pay on a particular date, to pay in a particular manner. If you don't do that, sometimes there are escalation clauses in the contract, which means your payments advance. So that can apply to sales, to sale and installments, to loans. So you have to be careful about those things.
Okay, so when you're brought into, say, the office at the bank to sign something or wherever, you should actually ask just to take it home, right?
I would imagine to read through it first, Can I look at this first? Yeah, that makes sense.
At the very least, I think you should read through it. And if it's a substantial amount, then I would suggest you take it home, because you know, the blood, sweat, and tears that went into the money making what you're going to invest wasn't that easy.
And Eirene, I was asking earlier about when in doubt, like there are terms that you just don't understand after reading it. What do you do?
I think the best is to ask somebody you can trust, either a banker you can trust who is not presenting the case to you, right? Mm-hmm. Or a lawyer. For banks, for instance, the charges, while there's a Truth in Lending Act, meaning they're supposed to disclose to you all these charges, sometimes they're just too complicated, or mm-hmm. you know, like for credit cards, for instance, they don't. It's not very clear that if you miss a day, mm-hmm. the interest will run,
exactly.
and then, you know, it runs away. So, and those are all in very, very fine print.
Okay. Mm. Actually, we have another question from Facebook. Ariel asks, "I'm from Marikina and a victim of both Ondoy and the recent monsoon flooding. I lost two cars because I didn't realize that my insurance policy does not have acts of God coverage. It's just that the agent did not tell me about it. Can I blame her for this? What can I do?"
Ouch.
Okay, I think that's something that I think Filipinos, another cultural trait, we're a bit too trusting sometimes. Mm. You know, like somebody sells
Guilty.
You something, then, you know, with
trusting.
A good marketing spiel, mm-hmm. you're hooked. So I think that's, sadly, that's lesson learned, you know, because
right.
you signed, while these contracts are called contracts of adhesion, meaning you just signed them, you weren't there when it was drafted, your signature implies that you intend yourself to be bound.
And you understood.
The same thing applies to insurance contracts. Mm. The good thing, though, is that a lot of insurance companies now for cars are already offering the coverage to include acts of God.
Right.
But that usually entails a hike in your premium, perhaps.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what I understand. It's super high, and it's mm-hmm. almost, you almost wonder if it's worth it to get it.
So that's something you have to do.
Yeah.
That's a finance question that
call,
you'd have
yeah.
to decide.
It's a call.
Decide,
like
yeah.
The
yeah.
risk, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you are prone, then
yeah.
take that hit because you're protected.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, Ariel, you can't blame her. Also from Facebook, May says, "I am currently processing my papers for employment in Dubai, and I am intimidated by the legal terms they are using whenever the placement agencies talk to us. How should I make sure that I don't get a bad contract?"
Okay, I think the good thing, though, with foreign employment, is that the government, I think, offers a lot of assistance
exactly.
to help you read through your contracts. That's assuming you go through going abroad legally.
Mm. Yes.
I think that's the benefit which I think the viewers should understand
appreciate.
And appreciate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. While you might have to pay some fees, you know, like a membership fees to the OWA and stuff, but at least somebody's watching your back. Because aside from finding out the nature of your employment, you have to understand, because all of these placement things, they require you to pay placement fund fees, right?
Exactly.
But what happens if you get there, then you're removed from your job without fault within a month?
Mm-hmm.
Does that placement fee apply to the next placement? I mean, these questions will only be answered by the contract,
right.
which I think if somebody is in a position to discuss it with you, that would be better. Otherwise, I think government can also offer that sort of an assistance.
Okay, yeah, that's great. She should go to the overseas employment
yeah.
agency then, just mm-hmm.
to help
look
her.
Over the contract.
Yeah, and get those big words clarified, right?
Exactly. Okay, another question from Facebook is from John. "I'm a freelance artist and work on different projects for different people and organizations. The contracts they asked me to sign are so different. I'm an artist, I don't like words, apparently. Where do I go to get help on trying to make sense of these contracts? Just sign them without reading them?"
I think that's number one. That's the number one rule with regard to contracts, more than knowing the legalese, is you need to just read.
Yes.
You know, so at least read. If there's something that shouts out to you, screams at you from the contract, I would advise that you hold off signing,
mm-hmm.
you know,
then
because
it's clear.
Once you're bound,
mm-hmm. that's it.
Then it's hard to get out of a contract. Sometimes some of these companies actually require you to pay bonds, you know, when you get out, you have to pay.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
So to avoid all of those and to avoid having a bad name in the industry, meaning you just keep getting out of contracts,
mm-hmm.
you should be more preventive, you know, meaning you study it really. If you don't like words, well, this is the one time perhaps that you might want to change that mindset a bit. Ask a friend
there,
to explain.
Exactly. Yeah.
Ask a friend. Who you trust, who you know has had a good experience
yeah.
in the mm-hmm. past. If not, you can ask a lawyer. Ideally, while it's good to perhaps ask the company, but it's also good to ask somebody who's not involved in the transaction.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah,
yeah,
you really have to
objective.
Read,
mm-hmm.
and you have to read that fine print.
Yes.
Even if it requires a magnifying glass.
Mm-hmm.
often it does.
Mm-hmm. True.
Actually, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, there is a reason they put it in fine print.
Fine.
Yeah,
fine,
they are hoping that, that
the ink is even in gray, yeah, sometimes,
exactly,
not in black.
They really make it difficult.
There laws against that. Seriously.
That's true.
Right?
There should be.
They should at least regulate the font size.
And color. I mean, not like gray.
Yes, exactly. Well, thank you so much, Attorney Eirene.
Thank you, too, for having me.
Send us your money questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
It pays to read. I mean, that's the bottom line. You have to read your contracts. Thanks for your time. That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for Talkin' Tips so you're always right on the money.